Part 3. Chapter 9. Mustafa Kemal pushed politics aside. There was man's work to be done. He must get to North Africa to fight the Italians. Except by the long land route through Syria and Egypt. Turkey was cut off from North Africa. The Italians had control of the sea and had closed the Dardanelles. The Turkish navy consisted of two battleships and some cruisers. Their boilers were rusty. Their crews had disappeared, and they lay struck in the mud up the Golden Horn. It was impossible to send troops. Officers who wished to go must get to Africa as best they could. Every young officer was planning to go. Anwar had gone at once. Fethi, who was military attaché in Paris, had made a run for it in a French fishing smack from Marseille and landed in Tunis. With two friends, Mustafa Kemal took the land route. They travelled across Asia Minor and down by Syria and Palestine, using the railway where it existed. But doing the rest on horseback or with carriage. Arriving in Alexandria, they found that the English had declared Egypt neutral and closed the frontier. Mustafa Kemal foamed at the mouth with rage. Egypt was Turkish territory, the English had no right there. And yet they had the audacity to close the frontier and forbid Turkish officers and troops to go to the assistance of Turks in adjoining Turkish territory. It was an outrage. Still, there was nothing to be done. They must get on. The three friends separated, each to make his own way as best he could. Mustafa Kemal dressed himself as an Arab and took the light railway that ran westwards. At the frontier he was stopped. He knew only a smattering of Arabic and, with his blue eyes and light hair, he did not look an Arab. The officer on the frontier post was an Egyptian. He had received a description of Mustafa Kemal with orders from the English commandant in Alexandria to send him back. The Egyptian was a Muslim and he hated the English and the Italians, equally with all Christians. All his sympathies were with the Turks. He could not, however, completely ignore his orders. Making sure that Mustafa Kemal was a Turk, he arrested another passenger with blue eyes and sent Mustafa Kemal on with a blessing. Mustafa Kemal made for Turkish headquarters, which were at An al-Mansur, 15 miles inland from the post of Derna. He was welcomed. There was a shortage of officers and, moreover, he knew the country and the people from his tour of the previous year. He was promoted to the rank of major and given command of the section facing Derna. His headquarters were in An al-Mansur. In An al-Mansur also was Anwar, in command of the whole front. The Italians, covered by their fleet, had seized the coast towns, but they could advance no farther inland. The Turks faced them. Behind the Turks was all North Africa up in arms. The jihad, the holy war, had been proclaimed. The priests had roused the people. From all Libya, from far down in the Sahara Desert and the oasis of Kufra, the tribesmen Ahd come swarming up to help the Turks, their brother Muslims, to fight the Christian invaders. Burning with religious fanaticism, they came pouring in to see Anwar. Anwar was the center of attraction. he had come as the representative of the Caliph of all the faithful from the Imperial Sultan in Istanbul. The Sheikh of the Senussi called him brother and sent his warriors. The distant Tuaregs and Fesani sent their volunteers, and Anwar knew how to handle them. He pitched a great tent with carpets spread on the floor and hung with draperies. Here he received in state, talked with the sheikhs and listened to the wild tribesmen as they squatted round. He organized their straggling hordes into groups of 40 tents, with a woman to each tent to cook and look after the men. To each group he gave 3 Turkish officers. He paid the tribesmen well, fed them and sent gifts to the widows of those who were killed. With untiring patience, with tenacity and immense energy, he inspired them to fight, and so pinned the Italians down to the shore. Mustafa Kemal was constantly in touch with Anwar. He was a year older than Anwar, but his subordinate in rank. The two men failed to agree. They were always at loggerheads. Both had in them the quarrelsome Albanian blood. Both were proud, touchy and strong-willed. Neither would stand opposition or criticism. And both were mentally and physically fearless and said openly what they thought. Otherwise they had nothing in common. Anwar was always inspired by great ideas, by far-flung schemes. The big idea absorbed him. He cared nothing for details, facts or figures. Mustafa Kemal was cautious. He was suspicious of brilliancy. Big vague ideas did not rouse him. His objectives were limited and undertaken only after long and careful consideration and calculation. He wanted exact facts and figures. He had no sympathy with and no ability at handling Arabs or any foreigners. He was a Turk, and proud of being a Turk. He despised the rest of the world. Since the first days in Salonika he had disliked Anwar. Now he developed a contempt for him, and he did not hesitate to show it. His contempt was envenomed by jealousy. Mustafa Kemal was convinced that he was the better man and the better soldier, and yet, though he was older than Anwar, he was always trailing behind him. It was Anwar who was in command always, and Mustafa Kemal his subordinate. To Anwar, living like a great chieftain, holding court in his fine tent, buoyed up with enthusiasm, gallant, open-handed and brilliant, Mustafa Kemal. With his grey face, his sardonic manner, his cynical remarks, was a death head at the feast. He took the heart out of the tribesmen. He criticized every plan. He sneered at every scheme. He was always carping and critical, but never quite to the point of being insubordinate. As time went on, their relationship became more and more difficult. The fighting was a wearisome series of raids and sniping in a barren country of rocks in intense heat, and would have frayed the strongest temper. They quarreled openly. Fethi, amiable and popular with all, tried to patch up the breach between them, and failed. Mustafa Kemal stayed in his own camp. He lived simply, in a small tent, and as hard as his men. He refused to go to the entertainments or to be part of Anwar's court. After a year of fighting, there was little result. The Italians had landed more troops, dug themselves in on the shore, but could get no farther. The Turks and Arabs could not dislodge them. Suddenly, and again without warning, in October 1912, Montenegro declared war. All the Christian Balkan states, for the first and only time in their history, combined and attacked Turkey. In haste, the Turkish government made peace with Italy and sent urgent orders to Tripoli. The Turkish troops were to be withdrawn to Egypt and the country declared independent. All available officers were to make their way home as quickly as possible. The enemy were at the gates. Turkey herself was in danger of complete annihilation.